If there's one animal we owe an apology to, it's the beaver. Pre-colonization, it's estimated their North American population was anywhere from 60 to 400 million. Then, certain people showed up. Not gonna name any names, but after they did, a bunch of beavers got killed to make hats and for the glands on their butts that make people smell good. So, of course, we brought them to the brink of extinction. Luckily, since nowadays no one wears hats or perfumes made out of beaver anymore, their numbers have rebounded. Today, the North American beaver population stands somewhere between 6 and 12 million. This is great because it means we've gotten to study their architectural accomplishments, and also because they're, you know, alive. What beavers are best known for are, of course, their dams. But, contrary to popular belief, beavers don't live in their dams. They do, however, use them to make an ideal environment for their homes. Beavers like to build their lodges, the nest where they sleep and rear their young, in the middle of ponds. The front doors of their lodges are a meter or two underwater. Coyotes and colonialists don't tend to swim very well, which is why George Washington crossed the Delaware on a boat. So the water keeps the beavers safe. The entrance even works in the winter because they're deep enough underwater that even the harshest winters won't freeze shut their front doors. Inside the lodge, they have a dry den above the waterline where they can sleep in warmth and safety. However, the perfect pond to build a lodge in doesn't often exist in nature. Instead, beavers have to manufacture these ponds themselves. And to do this, they divert streams with their dams. But before they make dams, they need logs. These logs, of course, they fell themselves with their own giant teeth, which are weirdly orange. This orange is a hard enamel. The back of the teeth are a softer dentin, which wear faster than the front, keeping the teeth sharp for chomping. And yes, they will bite your femoral artery open with those teeth, so be careful. Luckily, they prefer to target trees over knees. Generally, they chomp down trees that are between around 10 and 30 centimeters in diameter. But the largest tree that a beaver has ever been recorded felling was 115 centimeters wide and 45 meters tall. That's about as tall as the Arc de Triomphe is in Paris. A beaver can fell a 15 centimeter wide aspen tree, their preferred prey, in just 20 minutes. This is impressive. For reference, one day me and my friends decided to cut down a tree, and even after 5 hours, we couldn't get it down. But I did almost get heatstroke because it was the middle of July in Texas. So, with firsthand experience of how dangerous tree chopping had been, I had to wonder how many beavers get crushed by trees. I couldn't find any actual studies on it, but I did find a Daily Mail article that was as sensationalized and disrespectful as all of their other articles. However, scientists do believe that beavers can control the general direction they fell their trees in. Obviously not the beaver from that article, but on average. Some researchers who really like the number 8 measured 888 trees around 8 active dams in Cypress Hills Interprovincial Park. They found that the mean angle at which beavers felled trees did not significantly differ from the direction of their dam. You can see the data they compiled in this plot, where 0 degrees represents the direction of the dam. Beavers control the felling angle by creating a hinge in the tree. No, not a dating app. Besides, if beavers created a dating app, it'd be called Timber. Anyway, beavers leave some parts of the bark attached to the tree to guide the direction of its fall, creating what loggers call a hinge. Plus, they chew mostly through only one side of the tree, which also affects the direction. Not only that, but other studies also found that beavers tend to chomp down smaller trees the further away they are from their dam, most likely to make transporting the logs easier. Once a beaver fells its target tree, it either drags the logs back on its own, or else sends the logs floating down the river. It's unclear whether beavers participate in the pastime of log rolling or not. But when the logs get to the dam construction site, the beavers will either jam them into the mud of the bed of the stream or pond, or else they will let the logs naturally jam like arteries after eating exclusively Big Macs for over 40 years. And speaking of Big Macs, you can tell if a beaver is obese by looking at its tail. If the tail looks swollen and the skin is smooth instead of slightly wrinkly, you're looking at an obese beaver. But anyway, back to the architecture. Beavers strengthen their dams with twigs, leaves, mud, smaller branches, and other debris, and the dams, of course, back up the water and form a pond. It's further hypothesized that beavers tell their dams every day how much they love and appreciate them in order to keep them strong. The sound of running water triggers beavers to build or repair dams. This seems to be effective because with maintenance, beaver dams can last for decades. The longest beaver dam known to exist has been around since at least the 1970s. The length of most beaver dams range from just a few meters to a couple of hundred meters, but this one is 850 meters. Put it in a perspective, this biggest of beaver dams surpasses the size of many human-made megaprojects. The Hoover Dam in Nevada, for example, one of the largest dams in the United States that took 5 years and thousands of workers to build, is less than half the length of this dam built by a bunch of goofy rodents. The beaver dam is also about a third of the length of the largest dam humanity has ever built, the Three Gorges Dam in China, so you could say it's about as long as one Gorges Dam. A researcher spotted it in Wood Buffalo National Park in Canada while looking through some satellite images. The red arrow is pointing to the dam in both the image from 1990 and 2000. The dam does show up in aerial photographs dating back to 1975, but it's hard to say how long it had been around before that. It's thought that this mega dam was actually the coalescence of two or more shorter dams because you can see two different lodges in the satellite images. And to further control the precision of their ponds, beavers will also build canals. They will dig them out to foraging sites so they can swim to and from their lodge and be protected by the cover of water the entire way. Beavers will also dig canals to their logging sites so they don't have to drag the logs around if the river or stream isn't naturally nearby. Canals are also useful for maintaining the pond. By digging canals into the pond bed, beavers can maintain water levels, decrease the pond's sand content, and deepen the water levels during periods of drought. Some argue that beavers' dam building and canal digging behavior is advanced enough that it should be considered tool use. Because of the wide-reaching impacts of their dams, beavers are as important to the ecosystem of North America as their hides were to 18th-century supply chains. Their dams can help restore wetlands, which half of all vulnerable or endangered North American animal species rely upon. Not only that, but their dams make the water less turbulent and therefore a better habitat for delicate creatures like tadpoles. They help control flooding and erosion, and their ponds even help the process of denitrification. Their dams and lodges, with all their leaves and twigs, attract algae and bacteria that turn nitrates back into nitrogen gas, which is a critical part of the cycle of nature. So, it's a good thing we didn't turn every beaver into a hat. Thanks for watching, and if you see a beaver, make sure you apologize for that whole almost making them go extinct thing.